Hello, producer Auntie. I'm Jazz Galati, and welcome to this group function. Now, if you're new to the podcast, welcome. It's great to have you. A group function is where we work together as a team to find out a solution to a common problem. And the problem I'm presenting today, and I'm hoping to get a good answer from Pav today, is can you probe around implants? And what I mean by that is I was fed a lie or a semi-lie at dental school. Like someone told me, I don't know who it was, but if you use a metal probe to do a periodontal probing chart of an implant, you will scratch that implant and therefore that will harbor bacteria and therefore you should not be probing around implants. So for the longest time, I didn't check the periodontal health of implants. I know it sounds really bad, but as a GDP who doesn't place implants, not much to do with implants, I thought that was the right thing to do. I thought I was doing less harm by not inserting my Williams or WHO or CPITN probe in the sulcus to check for the periodontal health because I didn't want to scratch the implant. I was scared of scratching the implant, if you like. So I was expecting this to be a really quick group function, and I thought Pav would say, yeah, you totally can, it's all good. But Pav being Pav and the amazing guy he is, not only does he give us a really good definitive answer at the end, but he talks about the rationale of what the concerns may be and how you need to actually look a little bit deeper than can you probe or can you not, because there's some anatomical variation. So I'm not going to spoil it for you. Let's join this group function with Dr. Pav Khaira. That man again, Pav Khaira. Dr. Pav Khaira, welcome back to the podcast, my friend. How are you?
I'm very good, mate. How are you doing?
Yeah, great. So it's Pav from the Dental Implant Podcast, and I'm going to just pick your brains. You need to teach us something today, Pav. You need to speak to me like I'm 5 years old, because the following questions I'm going to ask you on this group function today is very much like basic things. Like, you're probably going to laugh at me like, Jazz, why are you asking me these basic questions? But I'm sure with the referring dentists that you've met and your colleagues, like, when it comes to implants, we come out of dental school, like a lot of other topics, and we're like, where do we even begin? So just before we dive into that, just remind everyone, people who perhaps didn't listen to our episode on finding your niche. I think it was episode 76 from memory. Do listen to Finding Your Niche. It's a cool one where we discover what is like your calling in dentistry. So do check that one out. But just remind us, what is it that you do other than these amazing transformations that you post on our Telegram group?
So thank you very much for having me on, Jazz. I'm going to be cheeky and just upload this as the next Dental Implant Podcast episode as well,
even though
you're recording it. So we have the same video editor, so it's an easy episode for me. Firstly, I just wanted to say that there's no such thing as a silly question. This is something that I learned really quite early on. Either you know or you don't know. It's really that simple. And I think anybody who doesn't know, who's asking questions that at that point, that then they shouldn't feel embarrassed or anything along those lines. So if I am being overly complicated with my answers, please feel free to remind me, because obviously for me this is fairly straightforward stuff. And you know, when I get excited about implants, that's it, the mouth starts. Okay, we all know that. Okay,
you're going to start talking about at the cellular level, biological level. No, we're going to go way simpler than that today. I know the kind of stuff that you talk about. You love that. You absolutely love that, and that's amazing to see. Though your passion is so evident.
But I'm going to make it really tangible for you guys as well. So a little bit about me. I graduated in 2002. I did loads of different things. I ended up getting bored quite quickly. There was one point I was doing endo, full smile makeovers. And ironically, I just didn't like surgery. I didn't like implants. And then I ended up getting into implants and I was like, oh, actually, I really love this a lot. I'm now at a position where I am fortunate to be at Evo Dental 4 days a week, and I mentor other dentists, and I still work at another practice 1 day a week as well, and I place approximately 1,800 to 2,000 implants a year. So that's obviously quite a big number. When you place big numbers, you learn to prevent a lot of mistakes, but you still see them. You know, anybody turns around and says to you, have 100% success rate. This is something that I've alluded to before. They are either lying or they're only placing one or two implants per year. Because if you place one or two implants mm-hmm. per year, mm-hmm. it's quite easy to have 100% success rate. So, that's just a little bit about myself. I do the surgical aspects of it. I also undertake the restorative as well, because you can't separate them. You know, it's mm-hmm. they're intrinsically linked together. So that, you know, that's just a little bit about me.
Amazing. I mean, it's crazy that number you mentioned. You probably do more implants than I do checkups. You probably do more implants than I do composites. You do you do more implants than I do any procedure. That's pretty spectacular. So you're totally the right man for this. So question number one of three in this group function is, can I probe that implant? Now, to give you some background behind this question, it's something that you may have heard before. Now, I don't know whether it is a myth or not, and I think it is, but let's just find out. The whole thing about if you use a metal, like a WHO probe or a CPITN, a metal probe on an implant, you will scratch the implant, which will then harbor bacteria, and there'll be a never-ending spiral of peri-implantitis in the future, and therefore dentists all over the world, I'm sure they are doing their BP, and they skip the implant and they carry on. Tell us about this.
So the question, as I understand it, is can you probe around implants?
Can you probe with a metal probe around implant, or is it a myth that you shouldn't, that you can't? Or just tell us generally about how to check the periodontal health of an implant in a safe way.
Okay. Do you want me to be really unhelpful now? Because the answer to that
No.
It's one of those, yeah. You know what I'm like. It's one of those. Okay. So the answer to your question is yes, you can, and no, you can't at the same time. I'm going to expand on that now. Okay.
Sure.
So I think we need to take half a step back and understand what's happening a little bit. Okay. So when you receive the final outcome let's just say restored single implant crown. Okay. So there's a number of ways that it can be done. The way to get the best outcome isn't done very often because it's more time consuming. It's more difficult to do. Okay. So the standard way that most people out there do it, which is kind of accepted, is you have quite a narrow implant in relation to your ridge, which is same height as the alveolar crest, and then radiographically it looks like a lollipop, tomato on a stick is what it's called. So you get this sudden, really, really extreme, what we call it, emergence profile. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, so probing around implants is different to probing around teeth. Okay. Because when you're probing around teeth, you're immediately going into the periodontal ligament. If you imagine you've mm-hmm. got this really wide implant, really narrow implant or a really wide crown. If you're probing straight down the side, you're not actually going to do anything. You almost want to be at 90 mm-hmm. degrees. And it ends up being really difficult to do, okay? So in those instances, when you've got an internal connection, the implant actually needs to be deeper so you've got running room to have a natural emergence, but then you need to condition the soft tissue with instead of just a standard healing abutment out of the packet, you can make custom healing abutments so you get a really nice smooth transition, okay? Now, mm-hmm. the reason why that is important is because when you've got a very acute and sudden emergence angle, it becomes virtually impossible to probe to the neck of the implant, but it actually mm-hmm. alters the bioflora, the biofilm next to the implant neck itself unfavorably. It becomes anaerobic as opposed to aerobic, mm-hmm. okay? So you've actually snookered yourself because what you've done is you've created a situation where you need to probe, but it's actually difficult to probe, okay? So the other way of doing it is once you've placed your implant deep enough, or the way that I do it is that I use external hex and I use quite wide implants. Because then
I'm going to stop you there, Pav, only because I think everyone's like listening, like, wow, they're like gripped by this, because this is very interesting in terms of the different connections and how you need to have that, you know, that runway room to get the best emergence profile. But like, if I'm a GDP, and which I am, and I see a patient and the implant was split, now I don't place implants, so a patient comes in, they've got an implant, I'm not going to pause and say, okay, what kind of connection is it? And now I will, because it's a great point you raise. And now I'll look at the radiograph and I'll see, okay, is this a lollipop or is this not a lollipop? What am I going to do?
Okay, fine. That's exactly the point that I was getting to. So the first thing that you do is you take a radiograph, okay? If it looks like a lollipop, there's not really much point in trying to do it, because the angles that you've got to get to, the pressures that you've got to apply, you're not really going to be able to probe to the neck of the implant. Okay. It is my opinion that, you know, if you can get to the neck of the implant, you should be probing to the neck of the implant. Okay. So you don't want to do it too aggressively. It should just be very gentle pressure. Okay. And what you're looking for is you're looking for the same thing as what you would do when you have a tooth. Is there suppuration? Is there bleeding? Okay. Not so much about the depth of the probing itself. Okay. Because you don't have a true periodontal attachment. It's like a long junctional epithelium. So you apply much lighter pressure. You're automatically going to have pseudo pockets going deeper. But the question is it bleeding? Is there suppuration? And as I said, is if you've got this lollipop type appearance, so you've got this skinny implant, all of a sudden really, really big crown on top, I don't think you can probe those pretty well. So why bother disturbing?
Is it worth still probing just to check if there's bleeding or separation?
So no, I mean, the test that you can do in that area is you look at your radiograph to see, is there any bone loss around the threads? We're going to come back onto that in a minute because I know that's one of the topics, okay? The next really, really, really good test is just with a finger, just push the gingiva either side. Because if you push the gingiva either side and you see suppuration coming out from one side, that's a problem. Makes sense?
I see. So you're kind of like milking the implant.
Yeah, massage. Milking the implant, that's exactly what it is. Yeah, so if you're massaging the gingiva either side and you've got bleeding or you've got pus coming out without even picking up a probe, that's a problem. That's absolutely a problem, okay? So let's say you're looking at the radiograph and you get this nice transition from the implant to the crown. It just looks like nice and smooth. Yeah, pick up a probe. It's not a problem. Just don't be heavy-handed with it. So what you're not trying to do is you're not trying to sound down to the neck of the implant or to bone. All you're doing is you're just going kind of like into the cuff a little bit. You're just going into the cuff and just sweeping it backwards and forwards. And you're seeing whether that triggers any bleeding, because that's a sign of inflammation. So it's not so much probing, as you're just seeing whether it triggers an inflammatory response. That's all that it is. But what you will notice as well is particularly with implants, is you get this little purpley band around the neck of the implant when in early stages of inflammation. So and in those instances, when you're looking at those purpley bands, you should immediately be thinking to yourself, something may not be quite right here. Okay. So I have no problems with people gently probing. If you could use a plastic probe, that's better. You've got a metal probe, you know, there's not too much data to go in between, because it swings and roundabouts. If you don't probe, you don't know what the problem is. If you do probe but you probe too hard, you're going to scratch things. You're unlikely to get to the neck of the implant, or you shouldn't be able to get to the neck of the implant. I think it also comes into play what restorative material has been used as well. Okay. So without going too much into it, there is a very good researcher called Thomas Linkovicius. He has done a fantastic textbook called Zero Bone Loss Concepts. He teaches on it. And the restorative protocol that he uses is highly polished zirconia on the thick surface against the soft tissue itself. And when you do that, and when you autoclave it and clean it properly, you actually get soft tissue adhesion to the neck of the implant, okay? So allow me to break this down a little bit more. I know we're going a bit more advanced, sure. But it's actually really relevant for what we're talking about. He did one study where he did restored single implant crowns, okay, using zirconia. On half of the fit surface against the soft tissue, he used his zero bone loss concepts, which is highly polished, no glaze, okay? On the other half of the same implant, he used glaze over the surface, and he fit it.
Clever.
And 6 months later, he probed around that implant, okay? The average probing depth of the polished area was 1 to 2 millimeters. The average probing depth around the glazed area was 2 to 4 millimeters. So, wow. You can actually get adhesion of the soft tissue onto the surface of an implant if you do it properly. So I think it's also important to know what material has been used, okay? Because if it's a PFM, you're not going to get that adhesion. You need to be much more gentle with your probing technique. The other thing that you can do as well is if you're going around, is as you put the probe in, you take it out and you wipe the probe clean with a clean gauze. So you're not transferring bacteria from one position of an implant to another.
Wow. Okay. That is a dedication.
Yeah, that's dedication. But, you know, that's something that I heard. But then I thought, then I was thinking to myself, you know, you're talking about not transferring bacteria from one part of an implant to the other. It still sat underneath the implant. It's still a problem, yeah. Right? So it's, and this is why I'm saying that there's no 100% correct answer. But I think what you need to do is you need to look at the radiograph and make an appropriate decision. If you see that lollipop on a stick, you're not going to get to the neck. Forget about it. If it looks like a really nice, what we call emergence profile, that really nice soft flowing type thing, then you think to yourself, yeah, I'll gently probe this. And to be honest, is if I have like my own implant crowns now, the zirconia ones, I'm less bothered about probing them because I know I'm going to get soft tissue adhesion. So I look at the adjacent teeth as well, right? So if the patient's cleaning everything really, really, really well, you're unlikely to have a problem with the implant. So don't take the implant as a standalone thing. Look at everything else around it as well.
Well, before we now come on to the radiograph, because you touched on that, and that was the next question about the thread exposure and what is a normal amount of bone loss. Before I get to that, I mean, when you find, if and when you find bleeding when you're doing the probing around an implant, I think that lends itself to a diagnosis of peri-implant mucositis. And I believe pus would mean peri. I know it might not be a hard and fast rule, but pus usually, from what I've been taught and I've read, peri-implantitis. Should I be referring to someone who is more clever than me in implants every time I diagnose peri-implant mucositis, just bleeding, or just simple local measures, improving OH is enough? Or do you think I should be actually sending them back to the dentist? Like peri-implantitis with pus, I definitely would be I would not be ignoring that.
Yeah. Local measures. So improve the oral hygiene, explain to the patient what's going on, and just treat it like a perio case. So you monitor it over and you reassess it over a number of months. And it is really important that the patient improves, because the other issue that you have is the crown cement retained, and is it cement underneath that's causing this? In which case, no amount of oral hygiene is actually going to do this. And what the data shows is if you do a cement retained crown and you can't get rid of the cement, the cement may cause an issue 7 to 8 years later. Sometimes it's not straight away. So, you know, a lot of people are doing, well, there's nothing wrong with cement retained crowns. And you look at this paper and it goes, oh, yeah, you know what? After 3 years, cement retained crowns have got no issues. It's like, yeah, but the peri-implant cementitis can be triggered 7 or 8 years after when you actually cemented it. So I think it's important to see whether there's a screw access in it. If there's a screw access in it, then you know it's screw retained. If there's no screw access in it, it just looks like a normal crown, then it's cement retained. And then we come back to the original issue that we spoke about. Is if you've got this lollipop type thing, being able to get a probe in towards the neck of the implant to get rid of all of the cement, never, it's not going to happen. There will 100% be cement there. So when you have just a little bit of local inflammation, by all means start local measures first. Really good OH. There are some products called Blue M, okay? I think that there's a mouthwash, there's a gel. They actually work really nicely. They are oxygenating. They've got oxygen in it, and it alters the biofilm for to be more favorable. And what you should notice is once you implement those measures, it should maintain. Like with gingivitis, you may get the odd flare-up now and again, but you shouldn't have anything persistent.
Perf, for me, your word is gospel. For me, you're the guy who if you don't know something, it's not worth knowing when it comes to implants. So I will definitely look into that product to help my patients supportively. But on to question two now. There we have it, guys. Hope you enjoyed that group function. And can you probe that implant? The next one is going to ask about what is the normal amount of bone loss around an implant. So as a GDP, when I see a radiograph, a PA, and I'm seeing a little bit of bone loss around an implant, should I be worried? I don't know at what point I should be referring on to the person who placed the implant or someone who, a periodontist maybe. So that's the kind of flavor I got. And the third question, which all will be covered in part two of this group function, is what do you do when you get an implant screw loosening? So as a GDP, if someone's implant crown is loose, I now know what that is, a screw loosening. You can hear about what I used to think that was, but it's a screw loosening. And is it cool for me to just enter the access cavity and just finger tight it or tighten it to what I think it should be torqued to. Is that a good thing to do as a GDP? Well, you'll find out very soon, either in a few days or in a week, depending on my workload. But anyway, thank you so much for supporting and listening. I really appreciate it, and I'll catch you in the next one.